tonight, no one was to blame. Schoolboy Hamdan Aslam died of natural causes. As tributes are paid, his parents say rumours surrounding his death have compounded their grief.
He's a really nice, quiet person.
All my nation is very sad because that's his good only 14-year-old voice. That's too sad.
Also making the headlines, warnings of water shortages as emergency supplies are shipped into some areas of the country.
In sports, tempers flare as Scotland's Josh Taylor puts his boxing world title on the line in New York City.
And I'll be in a sunny Rjukan Glen Park, checking out Scotland's major new trad festival, The Reeling.
I'm Emma Cameron in Edinburgh.
And I'm John Mackay in Glasgow. This is the STV News at 6.
Good evening. There is no one to blame for his loss. It was God's will. The words issued by the family of the 14-year-old boy who died at St Kentigern's Academy in West Lothian on Tuesday. It was confirmed by police that Hamdan Aslam died of natural causes from a pre-existing heart condition that went undetected.
His family have issued a strongly worded statement saying the misinformation and rumours on social media have only compounded their grief. Well, our reporter Ivana Holland has been following this story all week.
Yes, well, as I've reported through the week, it's been incredibly sad here in Blackburn and the surrounding area. But as soon as the news was reported about Hamdan Aslam's death, so too came unsubstantiated rumours online about what happened. And in that meant that threats were directed at the school here and the staff at St Kentigern's. And they said that that has left them feeling incredibly bruised and unable to grieve for the very student they tried to save. A room full this afternoon with thoughts dedicated to the memory of Hamdan Aslam, the 14-year-old who lost his life earlier this week. His death has been confirmed to be from natural causes. His community has been mourning his loss.
He was a really nice, quiet person. It's just like really sad, and you can't describe it.
Yes, very sad. All my nation is very sad because that's his good only 14-year-old voice. That's too sad. It's the same like my son, you know that. That's that.
It's very heart-wrenching. And everyone is very, you know, grief about it. And hopefully the parents and the loved ones and everyone else is, you know, would be able to cope up with it in the timely manner, yeah.
One of the mosque's trustees says everyone is in shock.
Overall, this death has been quite traumatic for the whole community. I think as a whole, not just for the Muslims, it's been very difficult for everyone at St Kentigern's Academy. Like, there has been a lot of comments on social media and conspiracies which have been posted online. But for now, what we would like is for the family to have peace and allow them to grieve in peace, pray for Hamdan, pray for his family, pray for his soul.
Police confirmed today, following a post-mortem, that Hamdan Aslam's death was from an undetected heart condition. It meant his death could have occurred at any time. His family released a strongly worded statement expressing their devastation at his sudden passing, but urging anyone who engaged in sharing untruthful posts on social media to stop and take them down, adding it was unhelpful to the children who were upset and it was only compounding the family's grief. In the last 3 days, the staff here at St Kentigern School have been besieged by threats from across the UK due to those rumours put about online. In a statement, the head teacher, Andrew Sharkey, described Hamdan as an exemplary student, always happy and with a beautiful smile. Lessons for social media conduct in such times will surely be a question for the future. But now, a family grieves for the death of a beloved son. Ivana Holland, STV News, Blackburn.
Emergency water supplies are being delivered to areas across the country as we start to see the effects of an early drought. The Scottish Environment and Protection Agency's latest report has highlighted the Central Belt now has a heightened alert status for water scarcity.
While groundwater levels don't affect water supplies in our homes, levels in reservoirs do. Well, Courtney Cameron joins us now from the Carron Valley Reservoir. So how are things looking there, Courtney?
Well, Emma, it's been another beautiful day with no rainfall. And while reservoirs like this may look reasonably full, the reality is across the country, they're actually holding 5% less water than they were at this time last week. Now, for this time of the summer, those levels are below average and it is causing concern. But the message is don't panic. We're all just being asked to be more considerate about the amount of water we're using over the next few weeks. The flowers are in plentiful supply, but the same can't be said for the water at this garden centre in Larbert. The dry weather is already affecting business here.
It's causing a bit of an issue for watering the plants, as you can imagine. We've got thousands of plants at this time of year. It's very busy with customers. We do have water tanks where we collect the rainwater that comes in and store it, and that lasts maybe a week or so, but unfortunately we've had no rain, as I say, for a month, so we've been running off mains water.
Just 20 miles along the road, Scottish Water tankers have been moving water from reservoirs to fill up reserve tanks in Kippin to ensure homes there are still receiving their usual supply.
For the last 10 days, we've been out constantly, both in the Highlands and here. Normally, you'd be expecting this kind of job in July, and we're started in the end of May.
Kippin is just one of a few rural areas across the country that's currently being topped up with water for households at the moment. But with more warm and dry weather on the way, Scottish Water is encouraging people to be more considerate with the amount they're using to prevent operations like this having to be carried out elsewhere.
Our volume of water that we see going out with customers has gone up by around about 150 million litres a day over the last 2 weeks. And we believe that that's mainly due to outdoor use.
So what can people do to help this situation?
In the garden, maybe not use a sprinkler or a hose, choose to use a watering can instead. Or if you're in the kitchen, make sure that your washing machine is fully loaded or your dishwasher is fully loaded so that you're making the best use of the water that you do use.
According to the Environment Agency SEPA's latest report, the entire Central Belt now has a heightened alert status for groundwater scarcity. In the north, it's more serious, with significant shortages being reported in the Lochmarie area. Farmers are urged to be extra cautious.
There's advice on our website for abstractors to reduce their water use, to stagger abstractions with their neighbours and to do all they can to conserve water. And by doing that, we can hopefully extend the period before we might have to step in and put in place restrictions.
Even though we're expecting some rainfall over the next few days, experts say it'll do little to alleviate the current situation.
We have had less rainfall across Scotland so far this year. We had a dry winter followed by a very dry spring in parts of western and northwestern Scotland. Then we've had the recent dry spell with high pressure and it's led to some very low river levels.
Dry weather also means there's an increased risk of wildfires.
From our point of view, what's really important is that whether in amongst vegetation of any sort, that they don't use a naked flame, whether that be a barbecue, a stove even, in amongst vegetation at the moment would be a risk in itself.
The Scottish Government is also urging people and businesses to use water carefully as demand rises. It says it's monitoring the situation closely and making preparations in the event the hot weather continues. Courtney Cameron, STV News.
Other stories, and the defence firm BAE Systems has been awarded a 10-year contract worth £270 million to work in the Royal Navy's three main radar systems. The contract with the Ministry of Defence will see BAE engineers support the rollout of new technology on vessels, including the new Type 26 frigates, which the company is currently building in Glasgow.
Thousands of people across Scotland who care for loved ones are to receive an extra payment. Those who are getting the carer's allowance will automatically receive the £270.50 from Social Security Scotland. There are an estimated 800,000 unpaid carers in Scotland, including 30,000 under the age of 18.
Childline delivered more than 8,000 counselling sessions to children in Scotland last year. The top concerns included mental health, family relationships and friendship issues. The children's charity NSPCC is celebrating Childhood Day to raise funds and awareness for the service.
One of the things that we hear from children and young people at the moment is that the services there to support mental health are ever pressurised, and it's harder for them to access the support that they need when they need it. So they tend to come through to Childline talking about how they feel, what's impacting their mental health.
There's a call for individual cigarettes to have health warnings. The charity ASH Scotland wants Holyrood to follow in the footsteps of Canada, who will become the first country in the world to require such messages on each cigarette. The Scottish Government says it's considering a range of next steps as it aims to lower smoking rates.
Scientists at the University of Glasgow have been given a £12 million funding boost for cutting-edge leukaemia research. The projects will focus on understanding and predicting leukaemia and developing drugs for improved healthcare to tackle the disease. The type of cancer kills more than 300,000 people in the world every year.
This is one of the biggest investments in leukaemia in Scotland ever. As a researcher, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to pursue an entirely new line of research that could really change medical care in blood cancer. So it's an amazing opportunity.
7 years since being evacuated from their property, homeowners in the south side of Glasgow say they're fed up paying mortgages on flats that have been left to rot. The tenement in Govan Hill was deemed unsafe by Glasgow City Council in 2016 after an internal wall collapsed. A notice has been served for the building to be demolished. Residents say they are no further forward with getting a resolution to their insurance claim and accessing the property again. Vanessa Taff has more.
Nestled in Govan Hill, this property on Annette Street has been empty for 7 years and has seen better days. Its owners haven't been able to get into their flat since they were evacuated. Michael bought the ground floor property for his daughter.
She really liked the house and the area as well, but then things felt a bit literally. The wall actually collapsed.
What is it like paying a mortgage on a property that's in this state of repair?
I don't think it's fair. It should have been settled many years ago. It wouldn't have affected the property at all. It's costing me quite a bit of money to do nothing with it. But the lack of information is really the worst thing about it.
In 2016, Glasgow City Council deemed the property was unsafe and that the owners would be liable for the repair costs. After a lengthy legal battle, which involved the building's factor and insurance company, the back of the property was stabilised. But since then, homeowners here say there's been no information about what's going to happen next.
We can't keep going on like this. It's seriously affecting everybody's mental health as well. And as you can see, this whole street's been renovated, except from our block behind us. Look at the state of it. You know, we need work done here as a matter of urgency.
Glasgow Council, who want to demolish the building, say they're still in talks with the owners and insurers' legal teams. They added, the parties have not been forthcoming on their plans for the building nor the issues for the delays in making any decision. The council has written to them on a number of occasions expressing serious concerns about the delay. The building's factor, Cumming, Turner and Watt Property Management, who are responsible for maintaining the building, claim they're waiting for a response from the insurance company before they take any action. Covia Insurance told STV News, we want to conclude the matter for all parties as quickly as we can. Our aim is to do so by the end of June.
The wall has gone.
In the meantime, these owners are in limbo and are forking out cash on a property that could be demolished any day now. Vanessa Taff, STV News, Govan Hill.
Now, Ronnie has a sport and another classic boxing standoff, Ronnie.
Yes, indeed, John. Big weekend of fighting, and it's safe to say sparks were flying in the Big Apple. Good evening. Josh Taylor says he's ready to make another dream a reality by defeating Teofimo Lopez and retaining his world titles in New York City. There were fiery scenes as the pair finally met face to face ahead of the headline bout at the world famous Madison Square Garden. Here's Jamie Borthwick.
After months of trash talk from opposite sides of the Atlantic, the Taylor versus Lopez grudge match moved to another level when they faced off in person.
You know what I mean? This guy, no one really has called out Josh Taylor. Who knows why? Maybe because he beat everybody already. So for me, I'm here. I'm here to come in there and take everything that you got. That's where we are, the takeover.
All right, good. I can't wait till you come and try. Can't wait.
Oh, I ain't no trying with me, man. Yeah. That's just the thing, though.
That's all it's going to be. It's going to be.
Everybody got a plan till they get punched in the face. Shout out to Mike Tyson.
Mike Tyson again. Here we go. Clown.
The Big Apple plays host to Scotland's biggest boxing export since the late Ken Buchanan in the early hours of Sunday morning. It's a moment Taylor has been waiting for his whole career. Undefeated, undisputed, and desperate to make more history.
For me, this is a dream come true, you know, fighting in a place like this, topping the bill, bringing the travelling fans over, the Tartan Army's coming over as well. So, yeah, I can't wait to get in there on Saturday and another dream come to becoming a reality. So, yeah, this is brilliant. And this clown here sitting in my way on Saturday is in my way. It's just another piece of cannon fodder. That's who he is.
The pre-fight heat has been turned up. Will Taylor have the cool head to see off his opponent when the bell rings for round one at Madison Square Garden? Jamie Borthwick, STV News.
To football, and Ange Postecoglou has spoken for the first time since leaving Celtic for Tottenham, saying he's excited to get started with the Premier League club. The Australian's time in the Parkhead hot seat came to an end this week as he signed a four-year deal with the North London club.
I can assure you that right through pre-season we won't leave any stone unturned, myself, the staff and the players, to make sure that when the league comes around that you'll all be as excited as I am about the season ahead. So I really look forward to seeing everyone at the stadium, in particular at our first home game, and look forward to the journey ahead.
Now, it's not an honest way to run a football club, the words of the Jags Foundation after Partick Thistle reported losses of almost £300,000. They say budgeting errors by the board meant the Jags could have run out of money last season, but the fans group hope to engage with the club and supporters to provide investment.
The blunt truth is that if we hadn't managed to win on penalties against Dunfermline in the Scottish Cup and draw Rangers, we would have lost well in excess of £500,000 this season. And because of the way the errors in the budget, we potentially might not have been able to pay the wages in February or in May. And that's not a sustainable way to run a football club. It's not an honest way to run a football club.
Finally, rugby, and Scotland captain Jamie Ritchie says they're determined to improve on a strong Six Nations campaign when they head to the World Cup in September. The skipper was speaking as he took a break from the Scots warm-up camp to return to his home club, as Stephanie Daly can explain.
Hi, my name's Jamie Ritchie. Play for Scotland.
Jamie Ritchie takes time out from Scotland's first World Cup warm-up camp to inspire the next generation at his first club, Madras Rugby, in St Andrews.
It's a pretty cool feeling. I think part of the reason we do what we do is to kind of give back and give those kids the dreams that you had when you were a young kid and kind of inspire that next generation. So, yeah, it's a nice feeling to be doing that here at my home club.
The Scotland captain led the Scots to a successful Six Nations campaign earlier this year, finishing a very respectable third. But he's determined to ensure they prove even more of a match for the world's best in September's World Cup in France, which will see Scotland compete in Pool B alongside South Africa, Ireland, Tonga and Romania.
I think just kind of working on the things that we've got better at. I think we know that it wasn't perfect. Like, there's a couple of games in there that we were not necessarily frustrated with, but we knew we could have done a little bit better. So it's just trying to find those little bits of growth and bring them into our game and get those kind of consistent 80-minute performances where we can compete with the best teams in the world.
And Ritchie says continuity is key after head coach Gregor Townsend signed a new deal until April 2026.
I think it's great to kind of have that knowledge that's going to be the way it is for the next few years. I think it'll give guys confidence knowing that with them they've got a little bit of money in the bank and they kind of know the trajectory that the team's on and that little bit of continuity as well. So, yeah, it's a great thing for us.
And the Scots will be backed by an enthusiastic support in their first warm-up test against Italy at Murrayfield next month. Stephanie Daly, STV News.
Reminds me of me when I'm on the putting green. That's your spot.
Thanks for that, Ronnie. Well, it's been another glorious day out there, but is it set to last? Here's Joe Faro with hopefully some good news.
Get set for a wet spell. Tui's sponsors STV Weather.
Hello, at the weekend we are going to see some warm and humid air pulling its way up through Scotland and lifting the temperatures into the mid-20s. Accompanying that, there will be heavy and thundery showers. Not for everybody, but we'll see clusters of those pulling their way up the west coast to northwestern Scotland through Saturday night into Sunday, with some torrential downpours and the risk of flash flooding. Before that, we've still got the settled weather. It's dry, quiet, with the easterly breeze bringing in the cloud once more. And in the clearest skies, temperatures will dip down to around 7 or 8, but it is going to stay milder out towards the west. So a fine start as we go into Saturday, the cloud just pulling back towards the coast, and many areas will start off dry and sunny and soon warming up, lifting the temperatures widely from 20 to perhaps 26 Celsius as we go through Saturday and feeling more humid and also close. Then we begin to see the heavy showers pulling their way up from the southwest, working their way up across western Scotland to the northwest. The Met Office have a weather warning because these could bring impacts of flash flooding, gusty winds and some hail as well. Some areas miss all of them, but they may just begin to drift their way across more of Scotland as we go into the start of the new week. Goodbye.
TUI sponsors STV Weather.
A small town on the Firth of Clyde is celebrating after not one, but two establishments were named the best in the UK.
The train station at Weems Bay, as well as the butcher shop, have both come out on top in national competitions. Both had to beat off dozens of entrants to take the highly coveted top spots. Susan Ripple reports.
There's a team of locals here in Weems Bay who work hard to make this more than just a train station. And now their dedication has paid off. It's been named the best in the UK.
This stood out because people remember it as being an iconic station. They look into the stories behind it. They hear about the volunteers doing their work. And really joy and love, dedication, those kind of things are what make it. In fact, there's a train coming in now, as you can see, coming another sort of load of tourists coming in to use it. And also, well, it's a used station. It's a useful station.
The volunteers ensure there are always flowers in the station, and they've transformed disused offices, turning one into a community bookshop.
If you look at the visitors book in the bookshop, you find people from all over the world, and they're remembering their trips to Rothsay, Dunnawatta, train to Weems Bay, ferry to Bute. Childhood memories which stick in the mind. So I think it's one of these signature buildings.
That sense of pride, that sense of achievement, that the things that they do day in, day out to make the station look fantastic, with the flowers and the artworks and the statues and the cleanliness of the station, and the station staff who obviously help customers with their onward journeys onto the ferries and the surrounding community. I think it's just given them that real spurt to continue doing what they're doing and filled them with great pride.
And it's not just the train station winning accolades. Right across the road, they've won UK Butcher of the Year.
Nigel entered the competition in January. In the months that followed, mystery shoppers made a number of visits to judge it.
It's a fantastic accolade, and also for my team that strives so hard for excellence. Some of the team, Ian has been with me 17 years, who does all the counter and puts all the counter together. Jim, who makes the sausages, 25 years, and so on and so on. So a lot of staff have really been with us a long time, and they are over the moon, as am I.
And it may be a small village, but as these awards show, it's punching well above its weight. Susan Ripple, STV News, Weems Bay.
Well done, Weems Bay. And finally, a major new music festival is launching this weekend in the south side of Glasgow, featuring some of the biggest names in traditional music.
Yes, that's right. 10,000 visitors will be soaking up the sun and the music at the two-day event that's been organised by the creators of Sky Live. Polly Bartlett's been to check out the site before it opens to the public tomorrow.
Final preparations and final rehearsals. The Reeling Festival is just one day away from welcoming music fans for the very first time.
I was so excited when I heard there was a festival like this going to be so close to home, because that never happens. So I was just like, oh, I didn't even realise how needed this was. But that makes so much sense. Like, why does it not exist already? Sometimes I see people more outside of the country than I do here. So it's so ideal to have a festival in the hub of where it all happens, because we're always playing in the sessions and places like this, and we all know each other. And yeah, it's kind of like a homecoming festival for us. So it's really exciting.
The festival site is huge. Behind me, we have the main stage, which is where some of the biggest names in trad music will be performing. And if you follow me over here through the trees is the second stage, and that will feature emerging artists. Plus, one of the best things about a festival, the food.
This is the first major outdoor traditional music festival to take place in the Central Belt. It's been created by the organiser of the ever-popular Sky Live.
They like to look around and just find really, really exciting bands. There's a lot of great, exciting bands that have been about for a long time, but bands that are also up and coming, you know, like bands like Talus, who've had a huge growth in the last few years. Yeah, I think it's easy to pigeonhole traditional music is one type of thing, but there's a load of different sounds, and you know, there's some more contemporary stuff, there's more stuff that's rooted in the kind of the old tunes.
And a surprise last minute addition to the bill is Cammy Barnes, fresh from the Britain's Got Talent stage.
I was the only Scottish person who was flying the flag for Scotland, so yeah, I had a beautiful experience doing that until I got put out by a guy in his pants, but I'm at it. We're playing amazing festivals in Scotland. Life's good. Went on Lorraine Kelly during the BGT campaign, and Lorraine's been like a wee mammy to me recently. She's been retweeting all my tweets, and yeah, I feel totally hard having Lorraine in my corner fighting for me. So I've got the best corner ever.
10,000 visitors will be welcomed to the park this weekend, making the Reeling the perfect place to soak up the sun and the best artists in Scottish music. Polly Bartlett, STV News, on the south side of Glasgow.
Well, we'll have more from the Reeling on What's on Scotland at 7.
From all of us here, have a great weekend. Good night.
Bye-bye.